Our video project delves into the intricate tapestry of indigeneity in the Andes. Our group felt compelled to weave together a narrative that amplifies the voices and stories of locals who live and breathe the rich cultural heritage of this region. By incorporating these authentic voices, we aim not only to honor their perspectives, but also to highlight the invaluable knowledge and traditions that often go unheard and have been suppressed through the ongoing colonial process.
In our video, you will hear from Susana Bolivar Franco, a trained teacher and the executive director at Cusi Causa in 2023. With a maternal lineage to the Sacred Valley and a paternal lineage to Sucani in the south, all her life she has been living here in PSAC. You will also hear from Paul Steven Ferro Torres, a 27-year-old man working as a waiter at the PSAC Inn, whose family is originally from Cusco and who has lived in PSAC for the past 15 years.
Through their perspectives, we hope to illuminate the complexities of identity formation and the ongoing struggles faced by Indigenous communities in reclaiming and preserving their cultural heritage amidst contemporary challenges. To start, we ask both of them, how would you define indigeneity?
Bueno, para ser muy sincera y con la edad que tengo, este término recientemente estamos empleando o usando conscientemente. Porque antes, por lo menos aquí en el Perú, el término indígena casi siempre era únicamente para aquellos quienes poblaban en las zonas de la selva, ¿no? Pero cada vez entendiendo mejor este término, entonces podemos decir nosotros también de cualquier otra comunidad o de cualquier otro lugar, quienes somos propios del lugar, que somos indígenas. Pero ya no desde una palabra despectiva, como de menosprecio, sino más al contrario, con una identidad más fuerte, más enraizada y con mucha sabiduría. Entonces, el término indígena, que es conocido más a nivel mundial, justamente que tienen derechos, deberes, que tienen que recibir también ese respeto principalmente, es con este término que recién estamos tratando de usarlo, manejarlo, entenderlo y también para poder hacer entender al resto que somos prácticamente las personas que somos propias de un lugar y que somos igual a cualquier otra persona, pero que tenemos nuestra propia forma de vida, nuestra propia cosmovisión, nuestra propia cosmovivencia y que tenemos muchísimo por aportar para nuestros hermanos, hermanas de todas partes del mundo. Y de igual manera, nosotros recibir algo que nos traigan con mucho cariño, pero con mucho respeto a nuestra cultura, sin desplazar nuestra sabiduría.
Para mí la cultura indígena es muy importante, porque yo creo que es lo último que queda de mi identidad cultural, junto al idioma quechua, que lamentablemente en estos tiempos está desapareciendo, porque mientras menos personas lo practiquen, más va a ser la probabilidad de que un día el quechua quede simplemente en el recuerdo.
Susana speaks of indigeneity as a remaking, as a reclamation. She speaks of indigeneity as a reclaiming of responsibility, responsibility towards Pachamama, the Earth Mother, responsibility to pass on the culture and the knowledge, and the responsibility to remember and understand where you came from. Susana defines indigeneity as an identity of wisdom, as a consciousness. For her, indigeneity is place-based, knowledge-based, and intergenerational.
On the other hand, Stephen's perspective of indigeneity placed a central focus on the language Quechua. He spoke of indigeneity being forgotten and replaced. He implied that indigeneity would be lost if the language is lost. Here, he alludes to a notion of language as cultural memory. When you lose a language, you lose a whole body of knowledge and a way of understanding the world. The language evolves with the culture, and as such, language is both witness and historian, documenting what matters to a people and how that changes over time.
Through these conversations, we found that beyond the description of indigeneity central to our inquiry, there emerged topics touching the contemporary, connecting to our own positionality here in Peru. The touristic reality is known to PSAC, with ruins, haciendas, courtyard gardens, among the many commercial locations and attractions that cater to foreign travelers. We've questioned together before about how consumption of these many offerings of place are involved in the making and unmaking of indigeneity.
The commodification of culture is not covert, but to understand the embodied effects and affection, and to learn more of how people are in interaction or reaction to today's Andean reality, we ask directly about the themes of tourism and modernity.
Sino en muchas comunidades, en muchas localidades cercanas, en que nuestra cultura se estaba viendo solo como un instrumento comercial, nada más, turístico, comercial, pero cada vez era ponerse una ropa típica, cantar una canción solo por un tema económico, sin saber para nada toda la gran sabiduría que había detrás de cada actividad. La agricultura, la astronomía, la arquitectura, los tejidos, o sea, prácticamente todo un contenido curricular.
Lo bueno que ha traído el turismo, se podría decir que ha mejorado la calidad de vida de las personas aquí en Pisa. La gente ha empezado a tener más dinero, a mejorar su estilo de vida. Todo eso, incluso ahora Pisa no se ve tan atrasado como era antes, ¿no? Ahora ya tienen, hay bancos, hay tiendas por todas partes, las calles están asfaltadas, cosa que antes no se veía. Pero lo malo del turismo aquí en Pisa es que la gente se ha enfocado en hacer más dinero para el turismo, todo enfocado al turismo, porque cuando empieza, en la pandemia no hubo turismo, era fuerte para todos. Las tiendas estaban cerradas, no había cómo hacer negocio, porque todo estaba enfocado al turismo, al menos aquí en Pisa.
In Steven's interview and in our post-recording discussion, he found that people in PSAC are much more focused on making money and finding its economic outlets. Susanna highlights a similar issue in her interview, where people are profiting off of the traditional Andean dress, music, and animals, but the social and cultural values of these practices are obscured and deprioritized over their marketability. Mark Rice's Making Machu Picchu describes how locals create and alter narratives to appeal to global markets and to travelers. The popularity of indigenous culture and place like Machu Picchu bring economic benefits to the region. It also creates a dependency on tourism income.
Additionally, as tourism commodifies cultural heritage, there is a risk that the authenticity and true cultural significance of places like Machu Picchu may be lost or diluted to a superficial representation of the region's cultural realities. Hugo Blankel in We the Indians brings our attention to the pattern of economic dependency, where local economies are structured around meeting the demands of external forces, initially colonial powers, but now multinational companies. In PSAC and other places in Peru, such as Cusco, locals find themselves economically dependent on tourism, where their livelihoods are tied to providing goods, services, and experiences to cater to tourists' desires and expectations. While tourism is responsible for changes perceived as positive, it also raises concerns about cultural preservation, economic dependency, and sustaining local sovereignty.
Para un futuro. Entonces, un reto bien grande en el aspecto curricular es encontrar qué podemos ofrecer acompañando a estos niños jóvenes para que despierten en ellos este interés, estas ganas por conocer el mundo. Los adultos, la parte docente, directiva, ¿qué está pasando en el desarrollo propio individual de cada niño, pero a la misma vez sin perder el contacto con su contexto? Y uno de los espacios donde nosotros ponemos mucho énfasis, y que incluso es el propósito, uno de los propósitos por qué Jussi Causay se funda, es porque la educación convencional separó dos aspectos que nunca deberían separarse: la cultura y la educación. Estos dos aspectos en realidad están tan interconectados, tan entretejidos, porque al hacer educación haces cultura, y al hacer cultura estás educando también. Entonces, prácticamente no se puede separar, porque no son polos que se pueden separar o que se repelen, más al contrario, se necesitan. Y esta conciencia de una necesidad a gritos que se hacía en muchos lugares. Ahora, nosotros lo vemos también, la modernidad, la urbanización, como otro tipo de invasión, pero más camuflada. Camuflada porque podemos entender que, por ejemplo, lo que más se trata de producir en la nueva juventud es la individualidad, que el ser, bueno, más que ser individualidad, creo el individualismo.
Susanna speaks of an Andean curriculum that interrupts what we will define as the real, the economic emphasis and necessity of pleasing foreign demands, with the ideal manifested in the cultural revival by students who Hugo Blanco would consider the child of Andean geography. She is tasked with transmitting an interest, an understanding of the knowledge inside each act, removing participation from solely economic intentions. To this problematic separation in the mainstream between education and culture, Susanna is accompanied by what Hugo Blanco writes in We the Indians.
Globalization seeks to kill off the cultural diversity of people and the personalities of individuals.
Kusi Kausa combats the commercialization of Andean culture by nurturing their students to embody intentionality, to understand their stories, told through natural temporal cycles, and to feel the purpose behind the clothes they wear, the songs they sing, and to touch the sacredness of a cultural inheritance.
What is the purpose of education? For this, we need to look beneath our own curriculum. In De Gregori's How Difficult It Is to Be God, he argues that students entering basic education, and especially those entering higher education, are primarily seeking truth and coherence. He writes,
young people find themselves in a no man's land between two worlds, the traditional Andean world of their parents whose myths, rites, and customs they no longer fully share, and on the other hand, the Western world, or more precisely, the urban Criollo one, a world that rejects them as provincials, mestizos, speakers of Quechua. The students demand a sense of coherence, a worldview able to substitute for the traditional Andean one that is no longer theirs.
Susanna argues that the purpose of education is cultural continuity. Educate to perpetuate and practice, not just preserve culture. In a way, is this not also a seeking for truth and coherency? Rather than logic and hyper-rationality, this is a seeking for the truth of one's identity. The Andean cosmovision is a coherent worldview. Susanna and Kusi Kausa nurture younger generations to feel that the Andean worldview is theirs again in its truth and coherency, just as true and coherent as the countless theories offered by foreign social sciences and philosophy.
Here's Susanna contrasting different understandings of truth.
Pero sin dejar de lado esa desconexión que ahora existe, ¿no? Ahora existe esta desconexión con todo lo que lo rodea. Y uno de los aspectos que nosotros tratamos, que es un reto constante, pero que tratamos de seguir manteniendo vivo, es justamente que todos somos sagrados. No hay un ente solito, patriarca, que es el todopoderoso, y nosotros estamos aquí abajo, y que incluso bajo los humanos están los animales, las plantas, o sea, toda una pirámide, no, sino aquí es una red.
We have felt this cosmovision in texts written by authors who have cultural connection to the Andes, how Argatis approaches the animacy of nature, and Neruda grieves the death within overly modernized lifestyles, how Gregory Condori describes Anyi and the heartfelt exchange of labor. When we walked with Stephen into the mountains to visit the waterfalls, called Pakcha in Quechua, we felt the water was alive. There were offerings placed by people whose honoring of the sacred validated our shared feeling of natural force. This occasion is one of both real and ideal, shared with the land on which all is placed and changing.